Hi and welcome. In this video, we're going to talk about how to evaluate retrieval augmented generation systems, better known as RAG. We will talk what RAG is, how to evaluate both retrieval and generation parts of it, and how to use synthetic data effectively. This will be a theoretical introduction of the core concepts, but we will also have a separate practical tutorial. The core idea behind RAG is to give an LLM access to the knowledge beyond what it learned during training. For example, if you're creating a customer support chatbot, you will give access to your help articles so that the system can use them to formulate the response. RAG consists of two parts. The R stands for retrieval, that's where we search for the answer, and the G stands for generation, that's where the LLM processes the information it found to formulate the final response. Of course, it can get more complicated. You can rewrite the queries, you can provide additional sources, you can do it multi-step, but in essence, this is a two-step workflow. First find, then generate. And to evaluate a RAG system, it often makes sense to look at the both sides. First, you want to make sure that the search works and you can find the information that you should find, and second, that you can formulate the response that fits your standard. Of course, you can also look only at the final result and judge it by its correctness, but sometimes it's useful to look at both sides so that you can do debugging effectively. For example, you can notice that the LLM is hallucinating the response because actually you cannot find the information that helps you answer the query, or maybe you can find it, but then the LLM doesn't process it correctly. Let's start with the search evaluation. This is not a new problem. Information retrieval has been around for decades, and there are standard approaches to how you evaluate the search results. To do that, you typically create a ground truth dataset. In this case, for each query, you can provide a set of documents that contain the answers to this query, and then you can test if you can actually find them using metrics like precision at K or recall at K. And if you create such dataset, that is actually very reusable, so once you have it in place, you can run evaluations without any additional costs or setup. However, creating this dataset can be very time-consuming, so imagine if you have a question and you need to find all the documents that contain the answers to this question. Great if you can, but sometimes you cannot, especially if you're experimenting, for example, with chunking strategies, and even the definition of what you're looking for can be changing. So another approach is manual labeling. In this case, instead of preparing the dataset up front, you can just evaluate the results you get. And this is what many companies do, even Google. They have serious guidelines, 150 plus pages long, that explain to human readers how to evaluate the search results. Well, and you can do something similar. You could look at every retrieved chunk for a given query and give it a label, like relevant, not relevant, or partially relevant. And then you can aggregate results across multiple queries. However, this is manual, so you need to spend some time on actually doing this review. But here's a fun twist. You can actually ask LLMs to do this labeling for you. Basically, you'd create an LLM judge that evaluates the relevance of the chunks that you retrieve. Search engines have been doing this lately too. For example, here is a paper from Microsoft on how Bing does it. If you do it this way, you can run a lot of automated evaluations and then aggregate the results across multiple queries, for example, to check the share of queries where you had at least one relevant result retrieved. It is useful when you run experiments, for example, as you compare different vector databases or search strategies. But it's also useful during monitoring. For example, you can look if there are any queries where you have low relevance, then this can point to the gaps in your knowledge base. And also, if your RAG system returns just one context or maybe a few small chunks, you can evaluate them together. Basically, you can ask LLM to look at the context and ask, is there enough information in this context to answer the question that is being asked by the user? That would be a context quality judge. So now let's look at the second part, which is the generation. Let's say that you found some relevant context and you pass it over to LLM to formulate the final response to the user's query. Now you need to evaluate if this final response is good. There are two ways to go about it, depending on whether you run your evaluations offline or online. When you're running experiments or perform regression testing, you can use the usual ground truth dataset. In this case, you create a dataset which includes the expected questions and known good answers to these questions, and then you compare the answers that your RAG system gives you against these expected ones. You can do this using semantic similarity or create an LLM judge for correctness, or maybe create an LLM judge specifically for contradictions. It depends on how you construct your ground truth dataset. Creating these test datasets can be time-consuming, but with RAG, you actually have a shortcut. In this case, you already have a knowledge base that you're planning to use to create your RAG system in the first place. You can actually use the same knowledge base to create your golden dataset. In this case, you flip the process and you first extract chunks from this knowledge base, and then you ask LLM to formulate questions answerable from this context. This way, you create answer-question pairs that you can then later view and create your golden dataset. Of course, it still needs some manual curation, but it's much faster than writing everything by hand. Now, let's talk about what happens when the system is in production. In this case, you don't have the reference answers, but you can still evaluate quite a few things, actually more than in many other LLM applications. With ROC, you have not just the final answer, but you also have the context that was used to formulate this answer. So the first thing that you can look at is faithfulness or groundedness. Essentially, you can check if the final answer does not contradict the context that was retrieved. You can create an LLM judge or look at semantic similarity as a proxy. There are a few other qualities that you might want to look at, like completeness. Did the answer use all the information from the context? Helpfulness. Did it answer the ultimate user intent? Or maybe tone. Does it match your corporate guidelines and expected use case? You can also look at structural checks. For example, verify that your answer is within the expected length, that it has all the necessary disclaimers, that it always includes the link, and so on. These are deterministic checks, so they are very easy to verify. Side note. Since ROC systems are often external-facing, it makes sense to do some stress testing or adversarial testing. You can focus on quality, for example, throw in questions when you know that there is no answer in your knowledge base and then check that the LLM responds, I don't know, instead of hallucinating the answer. Or you can throw a few known gotchas, like for example, information about discontinued products or some past product versions. You can also test for jailbreaks and if your system is dealing with sensitive data or potentially has access through the ROC system to some sensitive information, you can definitely test for that. If we put it all together, here's what we get. To evaluate a ROC system, you can look at both retrieval and generation quality and evaluate them separately if it makes sense for you. In both cases, you can evaluate against ground truth or you can use LLM judges and other proxy metrics to evaluate faithfulness, contradictions, tone of response, and so on. So now we've covered some theory, let's take a look at how you can apply this in practice in the following tutorial.